Jonathan Gay was a young high school programming prodigy. After a failed run in architecture as a teenager, he received an Apple II from his family. He was enamored with the software development cycle as he could see the results of his work, and wrote a Space Invaders clone in BASIC on the machine. Shortly after, he switched to Pascal and wrote a graphics editor for the computer, which he then entered it into his high school science fair. After scoring well in that event, he bought a Macintosh to work on that platform. As this was in that platform's infancy in 1984, Gay's dad brought him to a Macintosh users group in San Diego. It's from there where he met Charlie Jackson, another budding software engineer. Jackson wanted to start a Macintosh software development company, and he already owned the $10,000 LISA development computer, a computer Gay heavily desired. Jackson figured Gay would be the right man for the job as he had little money to spend on employees, and Gay was certainly up to the task. Gay joined Silicon Beach Software, a company Jackson formed in late 1984, where Gay, still a high school senior at this point to his amazement, quickly began work on their first product, Airborne. The game became an early showcase of the Macintosh's power when it was first released in early 1985, thanks to its use of digitized sounds, one of the first games of its kind, as well as fluid animations for the time. The team from there got to work on its next product, which would be even more influential and served as a killer app for the Mac platform in late 1986. Written using 68K assembly with Pascal for its title screen and other small elements, the game proved to be a huge hit for the company. With its fluid graphics, penned by Mark Pierce, as well as its extensive use of digitized sound effects, working with voice actor Dick Knoll. After that, the team returned roughly a year later with Beyond Dark Castle, developed in 1987 and released in early 1988. Unfortunately for Mac gamers, this would prove to be Silicon Beach's last game, as the company also made far more lucrative productivity programs such as SuperPaint, which the company would focus on thanks to Gay's experience with graphics editors. The company would later be acquired by Audus in 1990, and Gay would become a full-time employee of Silicon Beach after graduating college. From there, he created a new graphics editing program known as IntelliDraw. And after becoming a modest success, Gay realized it was time for him to start anew. As such, he, Jackson, and Michelle Walsh all left Audus in late 1992 to form Future Wave Software on January 22, 1993. The two men, realizing that pen computing was fast becoming a promising market, thanks to the awards of Pen.OS, a pen-oriented operating system developed by the Go Corporation, began working on that platform using EO Corporation's tablet computer. Their first program would be SmartSketch, a vector-based graphics editing program using the pen extensively. Unfortunately, only months before SmartSketch released in January 1994, Go was acquired by AT&T, which did not see a healthy future in pen computing, and was killed off mere months later, with Future Wave selling only a few copies of SmartSketch along the way. Now, in order to get a breakthrough in the market, Future Wave ported SmartSketch to Windows and the Mac in early 1995. Now in the competition of Macromedia's Freehand, which had acquired Audus in 1994, Future Wave's distant ancestor, and Adobe's Illustrator programs, the product struggled to sell well. However, at this time, a little thing known as the internet was taking off, and Future Wave realized its immense potential, as suggested by some developers at the 1995 SIGGRAPH convention that summer. As a result, they got to work on modifying SmartSketch with animation, with this version focusing more on web animations rather than just graphics, though it was still a big focus here. At first, for browser extensions, there was no unified API yet, only Java, another existing web technology. Initially, performance was very slow, but FutureWave persisted, and in the fall, Netscape released a proper API for browser extensions, which clawed back much more performance. Initially, FutureWave planned to sell the product to another party as they needed capital urgently. After a product renamed to Future Splash Animator, they went to Adobe to sell the product. Unfortunately, Adobe would reject their offer, and after another failed bid to another company, FutureWave just decided to ship the product themselves, which they would do so in May 1996. At first, Future Splash Animator didn't do too hot, but they would gain their first major win in August with, of all people, Microsoft. The company was relaunching its MSN online service to be an online TV network, and used FutureWave's software to design the interface and animations. After garnering Microsoft's approval, Disney would come to FutureWave to use Future Splash Animator for its Daily Blast program on their website, and then Fox came for its Simpsons site that fall. The Disney connection led Macromedia to start knocking on FutureWave's door for a merger offer in November, of which they would agree to do so in December. As a result, the company, by this point investing $500,000 into their products, would be merged into Macromedia, and Future Splash Animator would be rebranded as Macromedia Flash 1.0. Gay would remain at Macromedia to oversee the development of Flash as the vice president of engineering on the team, while Jackson left to form other ventures. Shortly after, Macromedia redesigned their website to reflect the Flash acquisition, making use of its technology for its interface. This began a wave of other sites redesigning their webpages with the interactivity of Flash, combined with its then small footprint, eventually even earning traditional animators' attention such as Gabacorp and John Kay. Version 2 of Flash released in June 1997. This version saw the addition of some new vectors, bitmaps, the library of assets, and the ability to tween, make in-betweens of, color changes in animations. Gay continued to oversee development on an active level, highly unusual for a vice president role. The release of Flash 2 led to another explosion of Flash content on the internet, with its new capabilities, including none other than a Pennsylvania man known as Tom Fulp. Fulp, a man who had started a magazine in 1991 relating to fans of the Neo Geo, launched an online site in July 1995 known as Newgrounds Remix, an English translation of the words Neo and Geo plus Remix. Initially as a hosting site for various things, such as Fulp's own games of Club Aseel and Assassin, becoming enough for Fulp to make sequels to. At some point in 1998, he was introduced to Flash, and quickly became enamored with the technology, bringing it to his then secondary website, Teletubby Funland, along with a new homepage of his. Eventually, in 1999, he decided to merge both Newgrounds Remix and Teletubby Funland into a unified Flash site known as Newgrounds, and partnered up with Trauma Entertainment, an independent film production studio, to serve as to keep the website afloat, along with Fulp integrating a real-time chat room and a message board into Newgrounds. Fulp continued to make Flash games in the years since, most prominently the controversial yet technically impressive Flash game Pico School in mid-1999, a game made in the wake of the Columbine High School shooting, where Pico must take out a goth school shooter. Fulp used Flash 3, released in 1998, to make the game, using advanced features like a variable system, predating Flash's official addition of variables in Flash 4 in June 1999. As the popularity of Flash submissions were becoming more prominent on Newgrounds, Fulp made a section of the site known as The Portal to display Flash creations submitted to the site in mid-1999. This caused Newgrounds to explode in popularity, overwhelming the servers and folks' wildest dreams, and spawned a wave of copycat sites to form in the early 2000s, serving as the rise of the Flash portal. Sites like XGen Studios and AddictingGames.com made high-quality games of their own, like Defend Your Castle and Miniput, on their own sites, though they were often uploaded elsewhere. Back at Macromedia, Flash sales were booming, quickly catching up on their other web technology, Shockwave, and by now the web player component, the free portion which had spun off from the full creation-focused product for animators, was being distributed by every major browser and ISP with no extra downloads needed. Eventually, with Flash 4 being bundled with Windows XP for free when that launched in October 2001, using that component for its Tor program.
Welcome to Windows XP from Microsoft, the new version of Windows that brings your PC to life. Experience the best. Experience Windows XP.
And we haven't even reached Flash 5 yet, which released in August 2000, most prominently featuring a huge advancement in Flash's scripting capabilities known as ActionScript, allowing for a full object-oriented program to exist in Flash, the once animation-oriented program. While bits and bobs of scripting had existed as early as Flash 2, this marked a huge leap forward for both programming novices and experts to take a crack at the program. By 2002, even major businesses such as PBS Kids, Cartoon Network, Disney, and Nickelodeon were using Flash for games, with them often also using Shockwave, to say nothing of its use on websites in general for its navigation and animations, which are growing all the time. Animators continued to be drawn to Flash for its intuitive and easy-to-use nature, and the popularity of Flash portals continued to grow, even past the dot-com bubble burst of 2000 and 2001, which killed many other sites in the progress, though some sites like Newgrounds still struggled, losing their trauma partnership in 2003 as a result. Gay and the rest of the Flash team's work were still going strong with Flash 6's release in March 2002. This new version features support for two-way video playback and streaming, codenamed Tin Can by the developers, as well as the introduction of Flash Video, or FLV, along with new networking features and event support for ActionScript, in addition to Flash's first branding update since 1996. Version 7 followed in October 2003, adding support for ActionScript 2, which allowed for class-based inheritance and other new capabilities, in addition to CSS styling and the ability to run paid extensions and use authoring tools other than Flash's own, such as Breeze and Flex, for creations. This was also the final version to support the classic macOS and Windows 95, platforms that have been supported since the very beginning of Flash. As the program matured, high-quality free games continued to be made, such as Ultimate Sonic Flash, a Flash recreation of part of the then newly released Sonic Advance 2, and Bush Shootout, a satirical shooting gallery involving the then President of the US. The latter game showed that even sensitive topics like political issues could be explored at length, a topic rarely explored by mainline console and PC games at this point. And speaking of those types of games, some very successful Flash games were already starting to break into that front. Alien Hominoid, a Flash game released in August 2002, was ported and expanded in late 2004 for a full console release on the PS2, GameCube, and Xbox, and was ported elsewhere in later years. Flash games were beginning to get attention from awards organizations as well. 2005's N won awards in that year's Independent Games Festival, and award ceremonies for best individual Flash games were starting to form by the mid-2000s. By December 2005, Flash was now in its 8th major revision, now supporting GIFs and PNG images, new class libraries for ActionScript 2, and filters such as blurring, among other things, and was well above 90% market share in browsers, beating even Macromedia's own Shockwave in that regard. Heck, even the site you're watching this on used Flash for its interface to stream videos in its earlier years when it launched in May 2005. It's around this point that Adobe, Macromedia's main rival, started to snoop around the company for an acquisition. Finally, on December 3rd, 2005, Macromedia was merged into Adobe for $3.4 billion. Much of the Flash team would remain at Adobe, but for Jonathan Gay, it would be the end of the line for his Flash work after 11 years of development. He left the company when the merger was announced in April 2005 for other ventures inside and out of the software industry. Adobe continued to improve on Flash's capabilities into 2006 and beyond, where Flash games grew to newfound heights never before seen. After a short period of transition, Adobe Flash would be a true dynasty, though that is explained more in part 2 of this series, covering the Adobe era of Flash games.